everyone, Lisa here. I'm on the Atlantic Ocean, not far from Portland, Maine. What you see behind me is a buoy, more specifically, the B1 buoy. There are many different types of buoys off the coasts of the United States. Most often, they're marking hazards or channels deep enough so boats don't hit bottom. There are also buoys that mark entrances to harbors, sort of like welcome signs. This buoy here is owned and operated by the University of Maine. You can see its assortment of sensors taking measurements from the surrounding atmosphere and waters. It's one of many doing so right now in the Gulf of Maine. But the network of buoys in the United States goes far beyond our little Gulf.
The U.S. Integrated Ocean Observing System, or IOS, is a national network of buoys monitoring our oceans and coastal waters. The buoys in this network are owned and operated by many partner groups who share their data and make it available for a variety of uses. These uses include coastal planning, water quality monitoring, shipping, fishing, search and rescue efforts, and, more relevant to this podcast, their data are used to track climate and to generate daily forecasts, including severe weather warnings and marine warnings. Buoys come in many shapes and sizes. Most have steel or aluminum hulls. They may be discus-shaped or boat-shaped, and anywhere from 1.5 to 12 meters across. Most buoys are attached to the ocean bottom by a mooring, usually a really heavy block of metal or stone, with rope and or a chain attaching the block on the bottom to the buoy at the surface. The size and shape of the buoy and the type of mooring used depends upon where in the ocean it will be put. Rougher seas require larger hulls, very big blocks, and strong chains and ropes if they're going to survive ocean storms.
I'm here at the Chase Ocean Engineering Laboratory at the University of New Hampshire. I thought you might like to get a better idea of exactly how big these buoys can be, so I came to see one up close and personal. Why don't you come with me? Wow, that's a buoy. This is a discus-style buoy, not even as big as the ones I described to you earlier. I think you can see how big they are. Hey, if you're going to spend your life out in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, you're going to want a little bit of size on you. No, don't worry. The camera won't make you look fat. This buoy was part of a NASA program in the late 1990s, working on telemetry or sending signals back and forth between satellites and buoys. It's also been used in the Gulf of Maine, and it's been used to test ozone as well. It's a pretty impressive career. I bet you're proud. Do not try and sit on the buoys in the ocean. Very dangerous. So, I hear you're retired. Do you miss the ocean?
Each working buoy is outfitted with an array of sensors to make a variety of measurements. Those on top take atmospheric measurements, like temperature and wind speed and direction. Other sensors inside the hull record air pressure and wave height. Just below the buoy is often a sensor for measuring sea surface temperature. Some buoys have additional sensors that can measure the speed and direction of ocean currents, and still others have sensors that measure the water temperature at different depths. An onboard computer system in the hull controls data collection by the sensors, as well as storage and transmission of data. Buoys transmit data to land locations by either radio or cell phone towers, satellite, or sometimes a combination of one or more of these methods. Large batteries power the equipment. These batteries are in the hull and are charged by solar panels mounted near the top of the buoy. Some buoys are set out in the ocean long-term and may receive maintenance checks at sea every couple of years. Some buoys are set out for only certain months of the year and then stored on land the rest of the time. Other, usually smaller buoys with only a 1 to 2 year lifespan are free-floating buoys that transmit their data to satellites until they stop working. Some groups use their own ships or research vessels to launch and maintain their buoys, while the U.S. Coast Guard supports the repair and deployment of buoys for some federal groups like the National Data Buoy Center.
I told you earlier that B1 here is owned and operated by the University of Maine, and that it's part of a larger network of buoys. Well, the University of Maine is one of several partners in the Northeast Regional Association of Coastal Ocean Observing Systems. Whew, that's a mouthful. It's called NERACOOS for short. I'm going to give you a break from my voice for a little while and let the executive director of NERACOOS, Rue Morrison, tell you a little bit about that organization, their buoys, and the larger buoy network.
NERACOOS is the Northeastern Regional Association of Coastal Ocean Observing Systems, and our mission is to provide information for those who use and manage the ocean. We are one of 11 regional associations around the United States. We go from the Canadian Maritime Provinces of New Brunswick and Nova Scotia all the way down to Long Island Sound. We fund something like 15 buoys, some in the Gulf of Maine and some in Long Island Sound. NOAA is part of the Integrated Ocean Observing System. A wide variety of people use the information from, so a lobsterman going out would look at the data to go and see if he can actually get out to sea that day. Managers trying to decide on the aspects of water quality. The weather is not just controlled by what's happening on land, but by what's happening at sea. So we need that information so that we can have the good forecasts that we like to get from the weather service. For example, last weekend during Irene, the National Weather Service in Grey Maine used the buoy information to help judge what warnings they needed to issue for Maine and New Hampshire. It's important to keep the economy going because most of what we wear and everything else is all brought in by ship and all the heating oil and everything. Without the information, we couldn't actually be able to bring all those ships in and have everything that we need. And it's also important for understanding what's happening in the planet and how things are changing. Is that NOAA isn't just buoys in the water. We do an awful lot of other things as well, and one of which is operate a few forecast models. So we actually forecast the conditions in the ocean. We actually provide the majority of the information of what's happening underwater in the Gulf of Maine, the real-time information that isn't provided by anybody else. And yes, we keep all the data forever, and it's never going to be lost.
There are several ways to access buoy data. NOAA Weather Radio broadcasts continuous forecasts from local National Weather Service offices across a nationwide network of radio stations. Tune your radio to the correct frequency to hear something like this.
Winter storm warning in effect until midnight for elevations above 1,500 feet.
In 1997, the National Data Buoy Center implemented Dial-A-Buoy, which has since been updated through a joint effort with the National Ocean Services, both branches of NOAA. A person can call the 888 number from any phone, enter the buoy station identifier for the location they need, and hear a computer-generated voice read the latest buoy observations.
Wind northwest 320 degrees at 3.9 knots. Wave height, 2.0 feet. Air temperature, 64.8 degrees Fahrenheit. Visibility, 1.6 nautical miles.
Most groups that operate buoys provide access to the data on the internet. For example, you can visit the NOAA website and find the data for the B1 buoy featured in this podcast. As you click on the variables on the right, you can see the 12-hour graph in the dark blue section on the bottom change accordingly. Visit the National Data Buoy Center's webpage and you can click on any buoy that provides the center with data. Here you can filter your buoy selection by the program the buoy belongs to, or by its owner. You can also find the B1 buoy directly at the University of Maine's Physical Oceanography Group website. Here you'll find the most recent data for the buoy, as well as a host of historical data.
Check out one of those sites, or see if a university close to where you live deploys any buoys. Try tracking a few for a while to see how the measurements change throughout the year or during a storm. Now, occasionally a buoy stops collecting data for any number of reasons, so it's best to track a few, just in case you lose one. Well, that does it for this podcast. I hope you've enjoyed learning about buoys and how important they are to studying the Earth's atmospheres and oceans. Until next time, enjoy exploring Earth's systems. I'm going to explore the possibility of a little fishing.
If you enjoyed this podcast, check out the others in our series by visiting mmsa.org/EaSiE. The EaSiE Project is a Maine Mathematics and Science Alliance initiative funded by the NOAA Environmental Literacy Program for K-12 education.